Chronicle Books presents The Other Half of Happy, written by Rebecca Balcárcel, read by Ariana Cordero. To my friend Daryl, who has lighted my life since seventh grade, 1969 to 2015. Chapter 1. I live in a tilted house. A bowling ball on our living room floor would roll past the couch, past the dining table, all the way to the kitchen sink. And if the sink wasn't there, and the wall wasn't there, and the bathroom behind that wasn't there, the ball would roll all the way to my room at the end of the house. That's what it's like being 12. Everything rolling toward you. Quijana! Mom's voice thuds against my door. Mija! Dad calls. It's not really our house. We rent. But even if the doors hang crooked and won't close, and even if Mom never comes home till bedtime anymore, and Dad looks tired when he cleans up after supper, I like this tilted house. I get my own room, and there's a backyard swing. There's even a stove with two ovens, the upper one like a dresser drawer. We can bake peach cobbler and cheesy nachos at the same time. Like we might today, if we weren't destroying the living room, pulling everything off the walls. Quijana, we need another pair of hands here. Is she outside? I wish I were. I'd jump on the swing, pump my legs, climb high, and whoosh through the air. Then I'd sing. It's my secret favorite thing, even better than peach cobbler. When I sing out there, something rises up my spine and tingles the top of my head. The notes lift me up until I weigh nothing. I could almost let go and sail over the treetops. Which is another good thing about this tilted house. We can sing in it. Back at the apartment, way back when my little brother was born, Dad would strum his guitar and we'd sing ballads in English, boleros in Spanish. Then a neighbor would pound on the wall. Or the ceiling. Apartment walls are nothing but panels of saltine crackers. I'll check the backyard. No one can tell me why this house tilts. The landlady tried.
That old Texas sun turns dirt to dust. Can't build nothing on dust.
Mom says it's the clay soil that's under the house that slickens in the rain. Dad tells me the builders tried to stair-step a hill, putting each house on a bulldozed shelf.
But no one cheats Mother Earth. She's remaking her hill, filling in the shelves to make a slope again.
Mostly, I don't notice the tilt. But sometimes, like now, the walk from my room to the kitchen seems steep.
Quijana.
Dad's face appears at my bedroom door.
Of course I should be helping.
I hang my head.
The thing is, those boleros we sing in Spanish?
I've memorized the sounds, but I don't know what they mean. And now Mom and Dad are Spanishizing the whole house. Dad looks toward the ceiling as if he'll find a power-up of patience there. Ever since Tio Pancho called and said, "Adios, Chicago, I got a job in Dallas." Dad's been different. He's playing more marimba music on his phone.
He talked me into taking Spanish instead of Mandarin in school. Last night, Dad went over to help unload the moving van. We're all going to visit when they get settled.
Then I'll meet the whole family. Tio Pancho, Tia Lencha, and three cousins. They've lived in the States for a while now, but we've never been able to visit them in Chicago. The door flies all the way open, and Memito tumbles in. He thrusts a book in my face and climbs on my lap. He thinks my body is a big chair, just for him.
He wants to read, I say to Dad.
I'd much rather read.
A knot kinks in my chest when I think of taking down pictures of me and putting up paintings of Guatemala, the place where Dad was born, but I've never been. Can't we read first?
Read afterward, Dad says.
I start seventh grade in 48 hours, so I also want to load my backpack. My folders and notebook paper are still slouching in Kroger bags. They'll have to wait.
I stand up slowly, tipping Mamitho onto his feet. I guess we better. Dad leaves, but Mamitho's bottom lip pooches out. I know. He waves the book again and stomps his foot. It wasn't my idea. His face starts to crumple into a cry. Ride? I say. He drops the book as I lift him up. I hear Mom ask, "You didn't tell her, did you?" Tell me what? He's almost too heavy, but I hoist Mamitho over my head onto my shoulders. We march toward weavings and clay pots and volcano pictures. All pretty, but not home. We march up, 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 up the hill of this tilted house. Chapter 2. I set Mamitho down in a room I don't recognize. The walls are in the same places, but everything on them has changed. On both sides of the TV hang curtains of cloth, each zigzagged with sunshiny yellow and fiery orange. On the bookshelf sit two tall pots with red and green painted animals chasing each other around the sides. Dad leans over the computer desk and hangs a photo of people I've never seen before. "My whole family," he says. I guess he means his parents and brothers and sisters, since me and Mamitho and Mom aren't in it. "Where'd the baby pictures go?" I ask. Mom nods toward a cardboard box. "They're online anyway. We'll make a photo book sometime." Sometime? Sometime always means never. "Hold that side for me, would you, Key?" My nickname sounds like Key, K-E-Y, but I'm not a key player or a key factor. I'm not keyed up or keyed in. If anything, I'm off key, especially today. I hold one end of the large painting Mom is trying to hang. It's a lake surrounded by volcanoes. Lake Atitlan. Dad lifts his arms as if he might hug the painting, though it's too big for that. "The most lovely spot in the world. No importa la distancia. Siempre habrá un mismo cielo que nos una." Looking at me, he translates. "Distance does not matter. Always the same sky unites us." "I'm glad we finally framed this," Mom says. "This room needed a revamp." It looks nice and all, but I miss the baby photos and the picture of the Golden Gate Bridge that came from Target. Only Dad's guitar in its hangar is the same. Mamitho doesn't mind. He's rolling a toy truck back and forth. "I liked it before," I say. "Me too," Mom says, looking around. "But I always felt bad that the stuff was in boxes. It feels like a new house." That was my point. "Is it time to get out the package?" Dad asks Mom, his eyes twinkling at me. "Wait right here," she says. She brings in a white box, the packing tape already cut. "From your abuela, for your first day at your new school." Abuela is my dad's mom. She sends birthday cards and letters to my parents, but none of our Guatemalan relatives send gifts. We send them gifts, like Crayola crayons that are hard to get there and American brand jeans. "Starting junior high," Dad shakes his head. "I remember my first day of upper school. I wore a new white shirt and polished shoes. At your age, I learned to tie my own tie. 12 now? You want to stand out and show everyone who you are." Actually, I'm hoping to not stand out. To not embarrass myself. Everybody knows that standing out in seventh grade is bad. As in disastrously, monstrously, don't be ridiculously bad. Especially the first day. I swallow hard and fold back the cardboard flaps. A thick, colorful fabric unfolds in my lap. Tropical birds dazzle my eyes. It seems like a tunic or a long poncho. Yellow animals run in a wide stripe across a blue background, and below them, a banner of red diamonds.
Wow,
I whisper. It's totally beautiful and totally out of the question. No one in the history of seventh grade has ever worn something like this to school. At least not in Burr Oak, Texas.
It is a huipil, mija, handmade on a backstrap loom. See the birds? Quetzals.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.